Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this session of LitFest X. We have with us C.P. Surendran. He is one of India's finest modern poets, and he has published his collections include Portraits of the Space We Occupy by HarperCollins, Canaries on the Moon, Posthumous Poems, and Gemini 2. He is also the author of two novels, and Iron Harvest and Lost and Found. His third novel, Adal, has recently been published and open to very positive reviews. He was the editor-in-chief of DNA, India's third largest selling newspaper. Earlier, he has been a senior editor and a very well-known columnist with the Times of India. And his awards for writing and journalism include the Reuters International Fellowship at Oxford, Wolfson Press Fellowship at Cambridge, and British Council Literature Fellowship at Cambridge. CP, welcome to this session of LitFest X. You know, the topic is a very interesting one. We're really trying to understand, you know, how one can change the narrative of India from the current one of always positioning it as one of a lot of exotic and mysticism, if one can say. And through your book, although it's a novel, you have used a lot of the narrative to bring about a certain kind of realism, which moves the portrayal of India away from this exotic you know, beast, if you will.
Thank you, Kumar. Well, I think one of the reasons why people write is to interpret for themselves their world. But one of the factors also, which is very, very crucial in this determination of one's interpretation of the world, is market. Now, one of the problems that Indians face, Indian writing and Indian publishing face, is that although there is a huge number of middle class and upper middle class English speaking people, probably the same number as that of the population of the US or UK, they're unable to convert this number into actual a critical mass of readership. So invariably you are dependent upon the West for your larger marketing support, and you know, the larger prices are there as well. And abroad what is happening is that, you know, that the Orientalism which Edward Said spoke about, and McFarlane and other anthropologists as well, cultural anthropologists, have spoken at length about it, is a certain idea of the Orient. Here in this instance, it's India. And I think that notion is still being sort of worked to its last. So people tend to see themselves as interpreters of the exotica, which India is supposed to be. And I think that is a huge problem. And I have been trying to get away from it because I find that reality is, I actually find that, you know, not much difference between reality and the imagination. I would think that imagination is an extension of one's reality. For example, you can think all you want, you can dream, you can stretch your imagination to its breaking limits. And if you want to think of something, you'll still be an anthropophobic, an anthropomorphic image, an image built on man. It can be two eyes, two noses, four limbs, and green in color. It's some sort of an extraterrestrial. But nevertheless, what you are having is an extension of that image of the human, right? So in my case, I understand imagination to be an extension of the reality. And I think there's too much of it around us to actually exoticize it. It is already there. So my effort in all my novels, I think to a large extent in my columns as well as in my poetry as well, is to make sense of what is being obtained. And what is being obtained is not exotic or beautiful. What is being obtained is a very real, a harsh human condition.
And, you know, basis on what you say, how have you then treated India in your book?
See, for example, the my latest novel, Hadal. Hadal actually comes from the Greek word Hades, which is underworld. It also represents a certain very deep region in the sea, around 23,000 feet deep, where the density and pressure are very high, and only predators can actually exist there. So Hadal is actually about this unhappy young woman who has got a very sort of drifting relationship with her husband from Maldives, coming to India, and then falling foul of the the visa deadline, and then she goes to a police officer who's in charge of it and asks for an extension like anyone else would, and he demands sexual favors and she declines it. But she also finds, as he does, that everyone is talking giving a version of his reality, a fabrication. And the police officer himself, his name is Hani Kumar, and he himself is a great fabricator. We all are, as you know, Indians are very good at telling tales. Between the three of us, if we have a version of reality, by the time it reaches the fourth one, it is completely altered. The whole idea of Panchatantra and oral tradition, the entire idea of Vedas, for example, have been down the line interpreted, reinterpreted, and passed down. As a result of which, the Mahabharata, for example, there's a huge amount of extrapolation of material. And our oral tradition actually support that. So here she finds this lady from Maldives, her name is Rashida, Miriam. And she finds that she doesn't know how to get out of, say, for example, Hani Kumar's head. Because in her head, in his head, he has built something about her, because he is going to trap her now. So he has to build a whole world within which she has to find a way out. It's almost a bit like Inception, where there's a dream within a dream and you are unable to get out of each other's head. Now, the story is not, it's extremely fictionalized, and from the first word to the last word, it is fictionalized. But it is based on a true story. Decades ago, say 20 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, there is still an organization called Indian Space Research Organization. So it's called ISRO. So a lady called Maria, she had landed from the Maldives. She was a woman looking for some easy money and some good time, and she happened to sleep with a couple of people at the ISRO, and she ran out of her visa, and she had asked for one police officer to extend it, and the police officer had actually asked for a sexual favor, which she declined. And the entire tragedy of that particular thing, because the whole international media had descended on Trivandrum at that time. In fact, this story was on the in Time, a whole series of magazines, a whole bunch of magazines and newspapers, because there was sex involved, there was spy scandal involved, there was rocket science involved, and some very high profile scientists involved. Now, this police officer actually was able to bring up a whole new world in terms of fabrication and trap a whole bunch of people in it. And some of them lost their jobs. Some of them lost their reputation forever. Some of their families went mad. Some of them were really innocent. And this woman too was innocent. She was not a spy, because I retraced her step as a reporter and found that, you know, she was actually haggling with auto rickshaw drivers and hotel proprietors and pawning her fake jewelry to pay off rent. So she was hardly the material of James Bond. But the thing was, she was in a jail for 5 years because this man produced a whole series of evidence that she was a spy and she didn't know how to spell rocket, actually. And in any case, you couldn't have smuggled the cryogenic rocket technology at that time out, because almost all of it was available on textbooks and, you know, elsewhere. The problem with cryogenic technology, which is a liquid fuel technology, is that you have to adapt it to the local specifications of, you know, your weight of the rocket, the, you know, the geostationary orbit, all those things. So there is where the problem is. So there was no real secrets being smuggled out. And about a decade later, but in fact, it's only a couple of years ago that leading rocket scientist of that day, who was trapped in the situation, innocently, of course, got some compensation of 10 lakh from the government. But the tragedy is there actually is that Mariam Rashida was her actual name. So if you Google Mariam Rashida, ISRO, you will get the background details of this story. She left India after 5 years in a jail in Trichur in Kerala. You know, I am trying to imagine what makes people come together in this kind of a dark world, you know, and where is the exotica element in it actually? Because it is sleazy, it is prurient, it is sexist, it is corrupt, because the system is corrupt. You know, there's a particular line in Hegel's novel which talks about not just, you know, the system is not corrupt, but corruption is a system. So we are talking about that kind of a situation. And I know that it's very difficult to market this book abroad because this is nothing like what they expect. So the reality is very, and that reality is unfolding all around us almost on a daily basis. And so I am against the grand narrative of the exotica.
And, you know, how much of, you know, this grand narrative that you just mentioned, how much of it do you find not just in books, but even in, you know, the press, both in India and abroad? I mean, you've been a career journalist and a very senior editor. So both in India and abroad, how much of it are you seeing that even the press is sometimes just developing this grandiose, mystical sort of view of India?
It's actually quite terrible because, people are unable to speak the truth. And, you know, my own feeling is that truth is possible only in fiction, because it is there, you have a finite cover to it, a certain kind of resolution made to it. So it makes sense. The world within two covers makes sense. But abroad as well as in India, that's a version which is not likely to, although it's changing. For example, I've joined a multimedia venture as a creative director, and there the entire thrust actually is to make, to raise the question, if this is your land, where are your stories? And we are not looking at exotica stories. We are looking at stories which, a million stories which tell you what India is about. You know, what, and you know, the thing about India, you know, whether it's abroad or here, is that you still don't have an idea, a clarity, still, you know, obfuscated, covered in myths, in enigmas, in, you know, mists of time. You know, and I have a great, reservation in this subject, of course, ill-considered reservation, I must say, that we seem to have skipped some of the stages of, you know, the European civilization. For example, I think we have skipped Enlightenment. Our greatest enlightenment, I would think, or argue, was coterminous with the Indian independence movement. That was our great moment. And after that, it has been a bit of a confusion in terms of, you know, the modernity which we are talking about. And if modernity actually is is about the modern man, is about the project, is about separation of religion and polity, a unified market, a certain sense of people, a certain sense of state, the state. I think we don't have it. We are too diversified, we are too pixelated in the modern jargon. We are too pixelated as an anthropological entity to really make sense to ourselves. As a result of which, and this is the reason why I sort of condone what the West does. The West is trying to make sense of the other, in terms of language, in terms of words, in terms of literature, in terms of research, it's trying to make sense of the other. We are the other, but within our own boundary, we are unable to make sense of the tribals, for example. We are unable to sense, the Hindus are unable to make sense of Muslims, and vice versa. It is a very, fraught coexistence. And I would think to a great extent, someone like Gandhiji, which is one of the greatest ideas India has ever produced, understood that project failed, which was the reason why he was talking about the dissolution of the party and, you know, all that. But in the West has a definite problem here. The West's problem really is that they just don't know. For example, I would think, take a historical project like the America, for example. We are talking about Hanikumar and Heidel and his fabrications and how people got trapped in those fabrications, like people got trapped in your head. Now, I would think America's greatest failure has been actually, it has got a huge amount of achievements, but the greatest failure, which is actually leading the world into various kind of brain zones, is that CIA as a conduit of information, as an information system, CIA is a failure because they can't perceive the other. They can understand what is happening with the mullahs, what is happening with the Bajrangbalis. They don't understand it. They only understand a different idea of America as reflected in all these places. All these bases they have in Philippines and Saudi Arabia. They don't understand that. They really don't understand people there. So as an information system, CIA is great, which is the reason why you actually had Vietnam. The wars that America has fought are almost all based on misinformation. The Middle East war, for example, is completely been misinformed. So if they have this problem, I think the idea of reality, which is what Heidel, the book is about, the idea of reality is actually very, very fraught. We don't know, and this is not my original theory. I would think that a lot of anthropologists are saying this now, that we don't know how to look at the other, to understand the other without crushing them. And things are changing. For example, we thought, the Western, model was that you had a unified religion, you had a unified market, you had a certain capital system. All of that is disproven by, for example, China, and to some extent by India as well. So I am saying that that model is being questioned, and this book, to some extent, is questioning those accepted models.
Tell us a little more about, some of the other characters and, the secondary sort of plot in this. So we understand about, the lady coming from Maldives and then, getting entangled with the cop. But tell us a little bit more.
Well, actually, the writing of this book was also quite a story because, the first drafts centered around 53,000 words. And then I was told by my various publishers and editors and friends that you got to develop it more. So actually came back to the book after about 8 months or so, and within a month or so I put in about 30,000 words. It was quite a where actually the plot develops. For example, the earlier book was actually a satire almost. Here it is a, you know, a tragedy in unfolding with a, which ends to, you know, tends towards a certain kind of hopeful resolution. But around this time, I also realized that Maldives is a very fragile place. You know, generals keep changing, the models keep changing, and it's very close by. You know, it's very good, very close to India. But we don't know how to look at that. And there are these women or, you know, men coming in from there whom we look at as maybe sex objects. I tell you why. I'm not for a moment kind of trying to make this into a, you know, an exercise in imagination again. If you check those papers and the media, the reams of media covering this particular story, the ISRO spy scandal, you would see Mariam Rashida, the actual person, being portrayed as a sex object. All right, I have met this lady twice. To my mind, she is a perfectly ordinary looking person, dark, squat, you know, 46, 46, 46 kind of figure, right? And but that is, you can see that, but the entire idea of this lady as a sex object was commodified by the media in, you know, in South and India in general. And there's nothing, that is not the truth, but you can't see it. You can see the image, but you don't know it. So but in my book, for example, that lady becomes a little more within quotes refined, because she's attempting to write a novel herself, and she has an unhappy marriage where her husband is a bit elderly and a bit of a rebel, but also an alcoholic. The cop, you know, the Hani Kumar in this book, is corrupt, imaginative, and also an addict of cough syrup. So, and there is a boss that he has called Ram Mohan, and he himself gets a 25% cut commission from whatever deal he's, this man strikes. So the entire system is like, but he's a, the boss is a weak intellectual, because he is a great aficionado of, for example, Herbert Marcuse, the philosopher, you know, the one-dimensional man. He quotes, keeps quoting him. And finally, he takes a walk to the Himalayas because he can't handle the reality anymore. So the people are modeled on actual people to a great extent, and I have given them different kind of resolutions. That is what I have done.
Very, 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 very interesting, CP. You've certainly, you know, tried to use, if I can say, different lenses for otherwise what could have been similar characters or similar cast of characters, you know, in the setting of India.
Yeah.
You know, at this point in time, you know, in the session, we've got some questions coming in on Twitter. So if you're fine, we can take in maybe one or two questions from the online audience.
Sure.
So the first question which I would take is from Manisha, and she says, Mr. Surendran, what are the best poems or poets you think have had massive impact on society?
Are we talking about Indian society or international society?
She's not, so, you know, it's a question on Twitter. So I think we can look at India, whatever you'd like.
Yeah, I would think that, you know, although I'm just in the process of finishing my latest collection of poems. It's called Available Light. It's about 123 new poems, and 30 of those poems are actually about a Jew whom I met in a dream twice. His name is David. And I've written 30 poems on David, because David himself is having a dream, and it's about his concentration camp experiences. Now, I don't know if that collection, which hopefully Harper is bringing out, is going to actually change the world. But I do have a feeling that, you know, if you are going to write prose and poetry which do not depend on today's canons, which do not depend on today's, values of appreciation, and then you're looking at a certain world which might survive the next 50 years because of you have verbalized it particular way. I think it is in time that, you know, poetry, influences and shapes society. You know, the other day when I was really sick, I was down with chicken pox the last 2 weeks, and I was listening to Ted Hughes and Elliot again on YouTube. And you know, the lines they talk still give you a handle to the world. For example, when T.S. Eliot says, for example, you know, come with me, I'll show you fear in a handful of dust. It shapes a certain kind of vision of the world, which is still valid. You know, so it is not just Eliot, or it's not just, you know, Auden, or, you know, whether it is Dom Moraes, for example, you know, when he talks about his lover's breasts like melon. You know, you look at somebody appreciatively, and I know I could be badgered for this. You know, that line comes to you because, you know, it helps you to describe a reality. And I think it is actually very Adamic in its sense, because you are naming a thing. And naming of things is very essential to human knowledge and the idea of epistemology. And I think poetry has a huge function in that, because it helps you to name the objects and the realities of the world. I must actually, I'm sorry to interrupt again, Kumar. You know, I was also in the last few weeks, I was been reading a whole bunch on Paul Celan, who is a war poet, you know, and he writes in German, and he committed suicide when he was 47 or so in the Seine in France. He went through a traumatic time. He was in the concentration camp for some time. He came back. His country was not there. His language was not there. His parents were not there. They were killed. His lovers are gone. I mean, it is a whole history of loss. And he still writes. But when he writes, what happens is that the language sort of breaks down. You know, there's a huge amount of hyphenation of words. Words kind of slip down into just, you know, sounds. And there's no music, as it were, which is a very strong component of poetry, you know, the euphonia about it. But still, when he says, you know, when he talks about, you know, we drink the black milk of the morning, he's talking about the black milk of the morning in the concentration camp, and you know exactly what you're talking about. So what I'm saying is that despite the traumas and the, despite the, perhaps, I'm trying to perhaps console myself to some extent. You know, one has to get out of contemporary ideas of writing to be valid in future. It is a sort of immortality stake, and it is full of risks, because you may not get there at all. But that is all one can do, I would think, with a sense of risk.
Right. Some very, very thought-provoking lines there, CP. And, you know, we are bringing this session to an end. Thank you so much for spending time with us at LitFest X. And we look forward to your next book, which you mentioned is a collection of poems. And wish you all the very best for your recent book, Hedel. And we look forward to seeing it in the list of bestsellers very soon.
Thank you so much, Kumar. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.